Hello and welcome to Gaelic Football Views on CavanTV.com.
On tonight's show, we're delighted to be joined by members of the Cavan Minor Ladies Football panel and management.
Oh my God.
On tonight's show, we'll be taking a look back over a very busy weekend in Cavan GAA.
We'll be looking back at the Cavan ladies and men's games, as well as the St. Pat's Macquarie Cup semi-final.
We'll also be discussing the GAA Congress and the installation of Egan O'Farrell as president of the GAA, as well as taking a look at the Breffni League results that went on over the weekend.
Yes, but first, we're delighted to be joined by the members of the Cavan Minor Ladies Football Team, and obviously the two lads, the two Jerrys, and a part of the manager, Jerry Charters and Jerry O'Reilly. Folks, you are welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, guys.
Yous are in to discuss, I suppose, your attempt this year to retain the Ulster title, which your attempt starts this weekend, Jerry. Yeah. You have a home game.
We have an away game. Away game to Derry.
Okay.
We have next Saturday.
And just to explain to people who don't know and mightn't know, can you explain the format of how the minor championship runs?
It's basically on a league type championship. So it is. You really have to come out top. Top two teams. The group is split in two, and the top two teams play in the A final, and the second two teams play in a B final then.
Okay, and who else is in your group?
We have Derry, Armagh, Monaghan and Fermanagh.
Very tough group.
Tough enough, yes, yeah, definitely.
You won the under-16 A title 2 years ago. The All-Ireland title. Mm-hmm. And who did you beat in the Ulster on the way?
Monaghan.
Hmm?
We
probably just going to pass the mic over there. And
we bet Monaghan, but we didn't actually
catch him.
Make it to the All-Ireland final.
Yeah, you were beaten in the semi-final.
Yeah.
And was the under-16 the same format?
No, it was it was just you played everyone. It was just a championship.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it was a straight knockout.
Yeah.
And was Monaghan your toughest game at under-16?
Yeah, it definitely was. It was Monaghan in the final and it was a very close game, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. So you'll be Monaghan will be the team to beat, I presume?
I think Armagh were very tough as well. I suppose we didn't perform on the day during the final, so I'd say Armagh will be tough as well, so just take it one step at a time and see how we go.
Just to go back to Jerry, when did the preparation for this start? I know obviously at under 16 level and whatever, but when did the
we get started this back group of girls? At the beginning of November last year, so we started some strength and conditioning with the girls out in St. Pat's in the gym. So we had 8 weeks prior to Christmas, so we had strength and conditioning.
And Jerry, when it came to picking a panel, did you have trials or did you basically just carry on from the under 16 panel?
Yeah, we had trials in October, and we just sent out word around all the clubs and see what players they thought was strong enough to play county minor football. So I think we had 23, 24 in October, and kept some and girls fell away, and then the girls came back down from last year's panel. We got the group together then for November.
Okay.
And we carried on from that.
And is it a big panel? How many would you be operating with at the minute?
We carried a panel of 38 for a good while, and then we released 8 girls back at the beginning of February.
Okay.
So,
but good competition for places.
Yeah, there's a lot of competition now. The championship team probably still not fully finalised yet. There's still a good few openings, but we have a fair idea of what we want, but just want to keep the girls on their toes too, you know, so
that's it.
Keep it's competition good in the squad.
It's a good thing, and I suppose it depends on their performance on the show tonight. If they can handle the media situation, we'll see if they're capable of the rest.
You know, the pressure of this show, you know.
Oh, yes.
This is where it's all about. Like, Jerry, you know, you're out this weekend, you're out against Derry on Saturday, is it?
Yeah.
And it's 2 p.m. The pitch hasn't been finalised, but you think it's going to be an own bag in Derry?
Yeah, got feedback that they've played a lot of Derry ladies play a lot of their games in Owenbeg, so I suppose it's dependent on pitches that's available. But I know a lot of pitches up in Derry are fairly good quality anyway, so.
Well, Owen Begg is excellent quality.
Mm. It's like their school of excellence up there in Derry.
They don't let you use that phrase up there.
No.
Because they're not allowed to have a stand what's meant to be a centre of excellence. Yeah, but so they call it, I can't remember what they told us we have to call it.
Centre of Brilliance.
A Centre of Brilliance. Yeah, it is. But it essentially is a centre of excellence. Yeah. But it's wonderful facilities up there, and there will be a pitch that's capable of holding it anyway.
Yeah. We might go to Michaela. You're the captain of this minor team. What kind of how much of an honour is that to be captaining these girls going into an Ulster Championship?
Definitely a huge honour to be able to say that you captain your county, and definitely even better to be able to captain a group that we have very high quality, you know, people on the, and it's just brilliant to be able to play with them and be able to say that you're their captain, you know.
I'd say your family and the people of your parish. What club are you playing with?
I play with St Finbar's.
St Finbar's, so that's a mixture of a couple of teams down there,
Drum and Killambanoe.
Very good.
And all them and which club would you be out of the two?
Drum.
You're a Drum player.
Yeah. Okay. That was very definite. Drum.
Drum.
Don't even mention Kill.
And when did you start playing football, Michaela?
Oh, God. Probably since under sixes, you know, right, I was out with the rest of them and played Gaelic and soccer and did a bit of other sports as well, but I've stuck with the Gaelic until now, so I'll see it through.
And the name Gaffney would be well associated with the Kill Club, so it would. You've got Sean Gaffney there, plays midfield and played for the county as well, so are you related to Sean in any way?
No, unfortunately not, no, I'm not, but
But there'll be a new Gaffney that everybody will be talking about now.
Please God, you know, I might bring it up.
Take the holding up a new level. And where do you go to school, Michaela?
I go to Loretto.
Loretto. Very good. So you'd have had maybe Mick Flynn or some of them coaching?
We had Mick Flynn, yeah. Mick Flynn was actually over us there for our senior team. We were through to the Ulster final there.
That's right.
2 weeks ago or so. But we lost out to that. It's a very close game, but
still.
Hopefully you go one further with the minors. Yeah, Catherine, yourself, just as you mentioned school, how difficult is it to balance the whole, I presume some of you are doing leaving cert or transition year or whatever, how hard is it to balance the whole school thing and playing such an amount of football as well?
Yeah, it's tough, like we're training three times a week, so you have to kind of just prioritise. That's the way it is at the minute.
And the priority is the football?
Yeah. But even school football, like we were not in the Leinster semi, myself needed to go to Eureka in Kells.
Right.
Yeah,
very
so
good.
We were playing the Leinster semi, but we were locked out there. But it was a big commitment even trying to balance between school and club now as well. Just you have to just find the time for everyone and try
and what club do you play with?
Lurgan.
You're with Lurgan.
You're both
with Lurgan.
Yeah.
And but with Lurgan, is the club playing competition at the minute, or?
Yeah, there's nine-a-side at the minute.
There is nine-a-side.
Yeah.
The league is on at the minute.
That's adult nine-a-side, though, isn't
it?
And you're both playing on the Lurgan nine-a-sides.
Yeah.
Did you both play in the final last year, the junior final?
Edith.
You were in the senior team in the
which
senior
also
final.
Got to the final.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you both of you were playing in finals this year, so you were.
Yeah.
Very good. So
yeah,
you.
The senior,
that's right, you came on as a sub in the senior, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, you did indeed. We'll go to Auntie Edith then. So, Edith, how do you find the two boys up behind you? We have obviously Jerry is the manager, and then Jerry is the other Jerry is the selector, coach, video analysis. He's basically the dog's body, bottles the whole lot. He does everything else apparently. So he does. But how are they as a management team?
Yeah, no, they're great. They're very committed. Like, this is my second year with them. I played minor last year, but yeah, just the dedication is there, and there's Mary as well and Cormac. So. Yeah, it's great.
You have a great setup, and obviously the lads have absolutely no time other than the time that it takes to coach you, because they can't even shave.
Yeah, I don't think he missed one training last year at all. No, I don't think it was great.
And how many did you miss, Edith?
Is it easier for you to give a big commitment and put everything behind it when you see the effort that the management put in?
Yeah, it definitely is, yeah.
It helps.
Yeah, it does.
And what motivates you? Because you come up winning a lot through underage.
Yeah, under 14.
What motivates you to continue playing?
It's just the feeling of having a team, and we get along so well, the girls, like, we're great, like, we just...
Just as Damien mentions that, like, what gets you going or whatever, the senior team at the minute in Cavan, the senior ladies, 4 out of 4 in the Division 2, the Tesco Homegrown Division 2. Do you look up to them? Do you train around the same times as them or anything like that?
Well, I suppose we normally all try to get to their games anyway and watch whenever they're playing at home. So we look up to them a lot. And we know some of the girls on it from our minor team last year. We know them.
And they're winning the All-Ireland Intermediate in 2013.
Yeah.
We was all there for that as well.
Yeah.
So you just want to get up there and play a senior championship
for
Cavan.
Yeah.
And who would you look up the most? Who, if you could be one player, who's your
on
idol?
On the senior team?
Yeah.
You can't say me.
Even when he's in a dress.
Well, I suppose maybe Aisling Demon, because she trained us last year for a while.
Oh, that's right, yeah, she was involved with you last year.
So she, like, we know her very well. She'd be very motivational.
Is she a big loss to you this year when you are going forward with the minor team?
You'd know the difference, but... We've Cormac in this year, so he's filling the spot.
Yeah, Aisling has to get back on the pitch.
Yeah.
She couldn't stay away from it for too long.
She does. And what club are you with, Cuiva?
Kilishandra.
Yeah. Very good. And you go to school in?
Loretto
as well. So you were playing in that Ulster final, were you?
Final, yeah.
Disappointed?
Yeah. We were 4 points up with 5 minutes to go.
Three points up at half time.
Yeah. And then, yeah, they got a goal and a 45.
Right. And I suppose we'll go back to Edith, if you look up to the senior team, who would you want to be on the senior team?
Clara O'Reilly from my own club, she's definitely an inspiration. Emma McDermott as well, there's Fiona, there's Ciara, there's Fiona.
You just want to be all of them.
Yeah.
And we go back to the vice captain, Catherine. Yeah. Catherine, who would be your pick from the senior team that you would like to emulate the most?
I suppose just all the Lurgan girls and a few of the ones like...
You're being very diplomatic here. I always have your favourites, Susie.
I suppose Donna English has put in a hard slog with Cavan, and she's a great work ethic on the pitch and stuff. So.
And then Michaela, the captain, will go back to you.
Thanks. I'd say Laura Fitzpatrick. She comes from my club, it's not being like, but we're a small club and she's put in so much effort and she's on the starting team most of the time. You know, she puts in so much effort and she really is, you know, she has a good life as well and she's able to balance the two. So just hopefully I'll be able to
do the same.
Do that.
And what position do you play, Michaela?
Half forward.
When you're picked on the team.
Yeah.
Obviously. If you may.
Please God.
Wing half forward or centre?
Centre.
Centre half forward.
Yeah.
And what's your favourite part of playing football?
I don't know, it's when we play great, it's amazing feeling, you know, we all just gel so well, and especially coming out with a win. And to think that we were unbeaten last year in Ulster, that's what we want to aim for this year, and that's just the
overall feeling.
Yeah.
And what position do you play, Catherine?
Well, you may ask the two boys, because you know when you go. I play forward for the club and then midfield sometimes as well, and then I'm full forward at the minute, so I don't know.
You're not letting anything out of the bag. In case Derry are watching this, you're just focused. I like it. You're well coached. Jerry, that's a good one. You have a well coach, so you have. And Edith, where do you play?
Corner forward.
Usually?
Yeah, this year I'm kind of working back as well. So like I'm corner forward and I'm working around the midfield as well.
Coming out doing lots of work. And Cuiva?
I don't know, I'm a bit of a mixture. Well, I'm normally half back with club and school, or full back with school, and then I turned forward for our senior championship last year with club. And I don't know.
But before we go to an ad break, I suppose we go back to the lads to get their final thoughts. Lads, you know, what way is going to prepare now in the next few days? Obviously, you have most of the preparation done. It'll be just sitting down to pick a team and maybe just a light training session with the girls?
Yeah, probably just a light training now. We're training tomorrow evening, as we are, but we just go through a little bit of stuff with them, you know, tactics and that kind of stuff. And then tomorrow evening we'll have team talk and maybe just later on out with it, you know. And we're ready for Saturday, like, we're very confident, you know.
And what time will you be leaving at on Saturday morning, Jerry? Because it's a long way up to Owen Bay.
Probably, I suppose, around 8:30, I'd say. Probably stop on the way for a bit of food and
stretch out legs.
Yeah, hope to be there. Hopefully around 12:30, 1:15.
How difficult is it? Like, you see the Cavan ladies and the men's and the under 21s and the level of preparation that they're putting in, but they've got a lot more ability to go and find out about the opposition. Can you find out much about your opposition at all? Or?
I suppose you're probably looking at social media, maybe.
More so,
But Derry are an unknown quantity for us this year, because we didn't play in the A competition last year. So, and I don't think the girls have a whole pile of experience playing them either. So it's kind of been a little bit blind, but hopefully we'll have the quality to.
And then also in preparation as well, I suppose, getting sponsors and stuff like that, it's not easy to in these times to get sponsors and whatever. The senior teams and ladies.
Yeah, it's impossible to get, you know. You have to kind of go and look for your own money, basically, you know. Like, it is very hard, you know. At the moment, the girls are paying €2 a session to try and stump up a bit of money, you know, that kind of way.
That's like phenomenal.
Yeah, you know, like, so fair play to them. Like, it's something you wouldn't do in a club nearly, you know, that kind of way, and they're coming in to play a county at a higher level and they're paying for the privilege, you know. It's a pity too, but I suppose that's the road.
And do you have any main sponsors on board?
Not at the moment, no, we don't. We're looking for a sponsor.
Well, anyone wants to call?
Yeah, definitely wants to. They're more than welcome. Yeah, so yeah, you know.
Like, it takes a lot of money to run and to prepare a team. Yeah. And although it is an amateur sport, the more money you have, probably the better you can prepare, because you can do maybe bring in guest coach. Like,
And not only that, like, having won the under 16 Ulster A 2 years ago, this team have a great chance of going on and winning the minor Ulster. And last year.
Well, they won the three last year. They won the minor, the under 16 and the under 14 A, you know, like, so.
So for some company out there, for some business, it is a great opportunity to get their name out there, because it's not as if you're underdogs that are going to be bet early.
No.
So it definitely would be. It's a good opportunity for a business to get involved. Yeah. And as you say, any contributions would be greatly received. Yes, will. No problem at all. Tattoos on the arms or anything they need. Well, I have to say, look, at the very best of luck, and we'll be tracking your progress on the show, and as you go on, we'll keep in touch with you, and hopefully is.
And not only that, look, we can get in contact with somebody, maybe Jerry, one of the Jerrys. Yep. If we can get in contact with somebody at the game, and we can try and get updates to as well. Local media
because you deserve a lot of praise and a lot of coverage, in fairness. So anything we can,
it's not us really now. They have to put in the effort, you know.
You have to miss just training session.
I don't know, but that's just to get out of the house. So
but you are looking fit, like, you're
amazing. She never gets home.
But look, very best of luck, and thanks a million for taking the time to come in and speak to us. And as we say, we'll be chatting these over the coming weeks.
They signed the board.
They all signed
the board.
We'll get focused in on the board after the break. We'll change the camera angle then. So we're just going to go now to a quick commercial break, but join us for part two, where we'll be talking all about the GAA world in Cavan. So welcome back to part two of Gaelic Football Views on Cavan TV. We're going to start off now by just taking a look back over the Breffni League results, which took place over the weekend. There was a number of postponed games from the first week, which had to be played this weekend gone by. And on Sunday morning, Lavey took on Mullaghorn, and that was in Lavey. And it finished up 2 goals and 8 points to Lavey and 1-13 to Mullaghorn. So a 2-point win for Mullaghorn, Micky.
Yeah, good win for Mullaghorn, the first outing of the year, you know. Lavey, again, look, it's the Breffni League. It's early in the year, so, you know, it's a good result, though, for Mullaghorn to get their season kicked off.
It sure is. In Division 1B of it, of the Breffni League, Drumlane were taking on Red Hills. Drumlane came out with a convincing enough win here. 1 goal and 12 points, which is 15, to Red Hills 2 goals and 3, which is 9. Yeah. So, good win for Drumlane at
home. It is. It's a great win for Drumlane. But look, Red Hills are depleted this year. They've lost a lot of players in the lead up to this game, or in the lead up to this season, you know. There was a cameo by one of the greatest footballers ever seen in Cavan. He came on for the last 30 seconds of the game, the one and only Tom McCormack. And I believe he changed the game in that. He didn't change it at all.
In that Red Hills were doing rightly until he came on.
Yeah, probably in the last 30 seconds, Drumlane ran away.
That's a horrible amount of abuse for poor Tommy McCormack. But the second game in Division 1B saw Den taking on Cúchulainns, and this was in Cross Keys. Den scored 1 goal and 6, but Cúchulainns managed a big 1 goal and 14. So a massive 8-point win there for Cúchulainns.
Yeah, and the first game played in the new Den pitch, and apparently it's absolutely amazing. It's immaculate. It's a fantastic pitch. I was talking to the veteran there from Cúchulainns, Mr. Adrian Tate, and he said that, again, Den were depleted. They hadn't got a lot of their big names. He said Tomás Corr played well, and we couldn't really pick many more fellas for Den that actually played well. Martin Cahill wasn't playing, and he'd be a big player for Den.
And Ben Connerty wouldn't have been available.
Neither would
young Thomas Edward.
Thomas Edward,
as we'll come to them later in the show.
Exactly, they wouldn't have been playing because they had a bigger fish to fry. Yeah. But look, a good win for Cúchulainns after getting to the semi-final of the senior championship last year. You know, so they've started off 2015. Very well, you know.
Very positively.
Yeah.
In Division 2, on Sunday Sunday afternoon, this game was Drumlee took on Lara. That was in St. Finnis Park in Drumlee. And Drumlee scored 1 goal and 11. Lara scored 3 goals and 12 points. So a 7-point win
yeah.
for Lara. A very depleted Drumlee team, from what I heard.
Yeah, again, a very depleted team in Drumlee. You know, they're in transition at the minute. They were missing a lot of big players as well. Actually, the team that I saw that went out was still a good team, you know. So there's a lot of bodies to come back into the Drumlee team, and you know they'll definitely bounce back from that loss.
It's only the beginning of the league, but a good win for Lara. They'll be happy with that. They took part actually in the Paddy O'Shea Memorial Tournament down in Kerry the weekend before. That's why it was called off. So it was obviously good preparation for them to go down and take that weekend.
Yeah, that Paddy O'Shea tournament is a high standard, you know, and obviously, as you said, it was a good run out for them down there in that tournament, and they carried it on into the game against Drumlee.
Yeah. So the second game in Division 2 saw Swanlinbar taking on Ballyborough. That was in Swanlinbar, and Ballyborough come away with an away victory here. On a scoreline of 9 points to 15, so it was a 6-point win there for Ballyborough.
Yeah, this game was played in the 3G pitch.
Very good.
The neither pitch was playable, so they brought it down to the 3G pitch. And Swad would have been missing a couple of big players, you know. So Ballyborough missing Michael Argue as well,
and Brendan Argue as well,
who we'll come to in a few minutes as well. But yeah, look, a good win for Ballyborough, and again got the season off to a good start this year. So
yeah, in Division 3 there was only one game, and that saw Cornafane taking on Kildallan on Sunday morning again, and Cornafane came out with the victory here. Very low scoring game, 7 points to Cornafane and 3 points to Kildallan.
I think it could have been 7-3, as in I think they played a game of soccer.
All right. Yeah.
7-3. It was actually a high-scoring game
of soccer.
It would have been a low-scoring game of Gaelic. Now, I didn't get talking to any of the lads from Kildallan about this game. Usually, I'd get a phone call from the one and only Fergal Maguire, the Man Mountain, that is, and he'd usually tell me how well he played. But judging by that
scoreline, didn't play that terribly well.
Yeah,
by the looks
of that scoreline, he didn't
play too well. 7 points is usually enough to lose a game. and Cornafin won it on 7.
Yeah.
So it was, look, early season, there's plenty of work to be done there, so there is.
Yeah.
We'll move on now to the St Pat's, who are in the McCrory Cup semi-final on Sunday afternoon in Castle Blaney. And the boys from Cavan came out with a memorable victory and on a wonderful occasion. They finished with 1 goal and 12 points to Oma CBS's 2 goals and 4 points. That's the first time St Pat's have qualified for a McCrory Cup final since 1975. Absolutely phenomenal achievement there, Micky.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, we were down at this game ourselves. We'll have a couple of videos coming up now in a couple of minutes of the St Pat's game against Oma. But, you know, they never looked like they were in trouble. Even when they went a point up and then Oma got a goal, and you know, against the run of a point, a goal and a point against the run of play. But even Cavan still looked in control of that game, and they just looked confident and they looked calm on the ball. They went ahead by 6 points. Oma went and got a goal again in the second half. Looked like they were going to come back into the game. Cavan tagged on 2 more points. Yeah. And it was just an all-round performance. Having said that, the first half was where all the work was done. They were playing against a tight breeze in the first half, and they went in level at half-time. And we were saying up in the press box that if they could just get in within touching distance of Oma, the second half they should push on. And it was a very professional performance, is what I'd say. It was very, very professional. And they go on to face now Dungannon, St Pat's of Dungannon, and they'd be quite big favourites to win that game against St Pat's of Dungannon. Now, I wouldn't like them to take it lightly or anything like that, but they do have a great chance of winning their first McCrory Cup since 1972.
Yeah.
It was 3 years before the last final that they played in. You know, so it'd be wonderful for them to go on and win.
It would indeed. We might just roll to the video. There's highlights from the St Pat's semi-final against Oma CBS.
This is Oma CBS attacking in the first half. We were up in the stand looking at from the other side. So and that was the first score for Oma CBS. And that number 10, he was a good little player.
That's Keane McManus there, and he was centre back for Cavan, but the number 10 was Michael Corliss.
Nathan Donnelly, I think it was the way number 10.
Oh, sorry, yeah, number 12. This is the goal. Absolutely great goal by the centre half back, but he got the goal, Cahill Donnelly. But he wasn't really playing centre half back. But Cavan down at that stage, losing 1-1 to a point, but Thomas Edward Donoghue then, he won his own free there and slotted it over the bar as well.
It has to be said that he was absolutely exceptional on the day as well. Every time the ball went into him, he won it and he was willing to take on his man.
And he was fouled.
Yeah, he was.
Fouled a hell of a lot. But the work rate by the Cavan team and their ability to travel at speed, like, this is a phenomenal run by Dara Kennedy. Sends off Conor Smith onto his left foot. Conor battles to get it back and narrows the gap then to 2 points. So that left the 1-1 to 2 points.
And young Smith was very unlucky there because the ball was coming over his head and he knew there was a player coming towards him. And if he had won that and gone by him, he had a goal chance on. But he did brilliantly to win the ball back and then slot it over for a great score on his left foot.
This was good work by Brendan Argue there. He sends it back out and it's finished by Matty McKenna.
Yeah, and it had gone into Thomas Edward Donoghue. And Thomas, that's what I like about him, is that he can see the pass. He doesn't straight away think, I'm going for my own score. He likes to bring other players. He's a team player, you know,
that's,
and that was wonderful. Again, looking for the player outside. When the shot is on, he's willing to take it, but if it's not on, he's always looking for a player off the shoulder.
Marty McKenna with another score. That's his second of the game. No, dropped short, actually, that one.
Again, it was great.
This
was
great work by Ben Connolly.
Yeah.
That was Ben there releasing the ball.
And the goal was
absolutely brilliant goal there. Finished by that was Thomas Edward, wasn't it?
It was Thomas Edward who got it. Finished, but it was again, as you said, Ben Connolly, some great work to win the ball and lay it off to Thomas Edward. The whole aspect of this is he had a chance to put the ball over the bar.
Mm-hmm.
But he saw the man in the better position and thought that there might be a goal chance on him. It's just wonderful to see them not being selfish.
That was Matty McKenna taking the shot on his right foot and then it was blocked, so he turned onto his left and stuck it over the bar. But this just shows the work rate that's in this Cavan team. Like, they're constantly working us. Ted
again
on the ball, but great score here by Pierce Smith. This was in the second half, actually. wonderful score. That doesn't really give the best of angles for how good a score that was. It was pure quality by Pierce Smith, who finished off with 4 points, I think.
And again, almost CBS there attacking. That was the ball dropping short here.
This was the goal.
This is the goal. It was fumbled. Matty McKenna had a chance to pick it up and it fell out of his hands. At that point, it was 6 points up. The number 15, Gavin's name there, getting quite
excited
about scoring a goal.
I don't think he was just as excited at the end of the game.
No, he wasn't. But that
this is Thomas Edwards. Thomas Edwards,
great save by the goalkeeper.
Brilliant. He came out very well
there for Oma CBS. Wonderful.
Gareth Kennedy.
Just pulled off
to the left. But it was a good move, a good attacking move. Actually, I think he got the 45. Did he out of it?
No, there had been a free, and the referee, which we have to comment on. The referee was absolutely outstanding.
Kieran Branigan. Yeah, absolutely brilliant game, I have to say. Great use of the advantage rule.
Yeah, great, but brilliant use of the advantage rule. And if a foul occurred and it gave advantage, and he knew that it was a card, the play could go on for a while, and he would have come back in, got the man, took him out, had a word, and given him a yellow card. Just brilliant. He was absolutely, and that's the final whistle there. And at the end of the game, great scenes. I have to say the supporters for St Pat's were absolutely brilliant.
Very noisy.
Yes, the chanting that they had going on and everything was absolutely brilliant, you know. But they're through to their first Ulster McCrory Cup final, you know, since 1975.
And in that final, they'll face Dungannon, who we have a video of their semi-final, which we'll bring up now in a couple of minutes. But as we said, first final since 1975, absolutely phenomenal occasion for St Pat's. And that final will be played on St Patrick's Day. So it'll be St Pat's against St Pat's on St Pat's Day.
Yeah, that's it.
So it's all St Pat's. It's great to see it. But it's most likely going to be played in Armagh on St Patrick's Day. And I think it's usually around dinner time, around 12 or 1 o'clock.
It is, because we have the Club All-Ireland finals on that day as well. So they try not to have the two of them coinciding. But.
And we've been told earlier on today that there will be full live commentary of that game on Shannonside Northern Sound Radio. So tune in on St Patrick's Day to Shannonside Northern Sound for the full commentary. We're going to go now to the video of the Dungannon semi-final, where they were taking on St Paul's Bessbrook.
Bessbrook, yeah, it was indeed. So we'll go to that video. It's just to give you a little taste of what the Cavan St Pat's team will be up against. This game was played in Armagh. That's the wing half forward breaking through there. They look like a big team, a big strong team, game.
Yeah, physically they seem to dominate Bessbrook. That we were told, you know, that in the physical battle of it, Sebastian Gannon were just that bit stronger and really bullied their way through it. But that's a fine finish on the right foot there. Goals they've been putting through goals. St Pat's and Gannon, I think, the whole way through their campaign. So it's something that Cavan are going to have to be looking for. But that's a penalty there. Well taken.
I think the red team is the St Pat's Dungannon team.
I have no idea. I'm not brave enough to make a call like that.
I'm making that call. It's St Pat's Dungannon in the red. If I remember correctly, someone was saying about going in the media part of that. So they had scored a penalty. So again, as I said, like, they're big lads. You know, like you look at the Cavan full forward line. There's small lads in there, so there's, you know, but they're well able to get stuck in.
Yeah, the funny thing was that when the tournament started, the four top favourites were St Pat's Cavan, St Pat's Mahara, Oma CBS and Bessbrook. St Pat's Dungannon weren't really in the hunt for it, people thought, but it just goes to show when you get a team and put them together and they get out and work hard, they're getting the results and they're now in a final that nobody would have expected them to be in.
Yeah, and that'll mean that St Pat's and Cavan would win as favourites. Something that I suppose that stood out for me on the Cavan St Pat's team was that they had 10 county minors in the sub-division.
I think we made 12, did we?
12 in the
12
end.
And there was 10 of the team was overage for mine.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. 12 minors on the bench, and there was 10 players on the team. But that's something that Cavan haven't been able to say in a long time about a college's team, that they had 10 overage for minor.
There's some wonderful scores in this game, it has to be said. And it looks like it's a very open game. It doesn't it doesn't look to be as defensive as McGrory football has tended to be. Like it looks like they're getting chances, they're finding spaces. That's a massive, no, it's hardly a point, is it?
Not sure.
Dangerous.
Great chance. Over the bar.
Could have been the difference. In fairness, the best group, they really battled hard and never give up on this.
Whichever, you know...
That's a massive score.
Pat's Cavan, the team that they're playing is St. Pat's Dungannon. Like, St. Pat's Dungannon have played them in Armagh now, you know. That's a little bit of a, you know... bit of experience, I suppose, of playing on the pitch that will stand to them as well.
But then, well, people will remember last year in the semi-finals, St. Patrick Cavan played in Armagh, although they didn't make the wrong result. That was the venue for their semi-final last year. So most of these players played on that team last year. It'll be probably no big advantage, hopefully. But we wish St. Pat's the very best of luck. We just want to bring up a quick picture there. We have it coming up where it's a picture that was tweeted by John Denning, I believe.
Yeah, we want to thank John Denning for this.
But he tweeted a picture of the team in 1975, the St. Pat's team in 1975 that played in that McGrory Cup final. And funnily enough, we were told in the press area that the manager of that team was one Cardinal Sean Brady in 1975.
Yeah.
So we'll just bring up that picture if we have it. There we go. That's well focused in, so we'll be able to zoom that back out.
There we go. Yeah, and we'll just, I suppose what we'll do is we'll name the team as well from 1975. The front row there, from left to right, is Francis McGuire, Pádraic Martin, Paul McAvoy, Frank Smith, and he was captain. Our one and only Cyril O'Keefe from our own club in Drumalee, and Francis Junior McKiernan. And
Kilishandra.
From Kilishandra. Do you want to go through the back row?
The back row was Paddy McGovern, who again was from our club in Drumalee. Paul Myers, Martin Brady. I think that's the referee, Martin Brady. Robbie McDermott, again another Ballinyam, and that would be Niall's father. Donald Donoghue, he's a teacher out in Farnham. I think a Lara man. Ray Cullivan, another Lara man and an ex-teacher in St. Pat's. And Kieran Halton. So it's... now.
Kieran Harton, is it?
I think it's Halton.
Oh, Halton. But if you look at that picture there, I know it's on your screens there at the minute, they don't look like a minor team.
No, they definitely don't.
They look like a senior team that had tightened a senior championship in Cavan at the minute.
Yeah.
I wouldn't like to meet any of them at the pitch.
Most definitely, all big, big men. But the funny thing that I was just totting it up, there's only 13 players. I wonder, was it 13 a side or something like that at that point? So we'll look at, I'm sure that every one of them will be out on St. Patrick's Day to support the St. Pat's team going into this final, you know, because they really do need the support. And I can guarantee you St. Pat's Dungannon will bring thousands.
Yeah.
They won't bring a few hundred. They will bring 1,000, maybe 2,000 to that game. So, you know, St. Pat's Cavan really need to get everybody out behind them.
And you know what? I think everybody, I think Cavan will travel in their droves down to this game because, as we said, 1975 was the last time that they played in the final. You know, they've been starved of this. It's a wonderful occasion. It's usually shown on TV and everything. The support that were there that day in the semi final, the noise, the chanting, yeah. It was wonderful to see it. It was
so passionate.
The atmosphere was electric at it, you know, at the semi-final. And I just know that the Cavan people are going to get out and support this St. Pat's team because they have a wonderful chance of winning this one.
Well, I don't know when the last time we had a team playing on an important game on St. Patrick's Day was. So that in itself, we should get down in our thousands to Armagh and make it a fortress for us.
I'll tell you, the St. Patrick's Day parade organisers won't be too happy about that.
They won't. Peter McGinty and Mickey Mooney and them boys will not be happy, but they'll forgive us for going down this once.
They will indeed, definitely.
So we'll move on now to the National Football League Division 2 Round 3 match, where Cavan took on Down on Saturday evening in Kingspan Breffni Park. And unfortunately, Cavan came out on the wrong end of the result on a scoreline of 8 points to Cavan, 1-9 to Down. I think maybe we'll go to a video. We have a video of Terry Hyland. You were interviewing him after the game.
Yeah.
We'll go to the video and then we'll discuss the game after.
Manager Terry, a disappointing night here in Kingspan Breffni Park. Well, disappointing, considering at half time after playing into a Gaelic Football win, we kept it down to 3 points and we thought we could kick on after. As it was sending off, probably the major bearing from the point of view that we're playing against a team that likes to run it through the hands, and when you're playing the man down, it allows them to do that in the second half. You know, it was disappointing nothing came out of it with some result, because I thought we did work very, very hard in the first half, and perhaps we relied on our first half performance to try to get us through.
Yeah, we did an awful lot more attacks than Down did in the first half. They seemed to be a little bit more economical with the ball. They played a lot of long ball in as well, into the full back line, full forward line for them, I suppose, and we dealt with it well in the first half.
Yeah, well, I thought Jason and Rory were excellent for us in the full back line, and maybe it's a sign of where the ball is sometimes when you consider that the best players probably had is the full back line. No, I think that we expended an awful lot of energy maybe in that first half, and we're after having two very heavy weeks of training, and maybe that comes to tell end. But probably being a man down against a running team, you know, probably told in the end.
There's a lot of simple mistakes as well made, hand passes, the ball in hand, picking the ball up. It just didn't seem to be the usual Cavan way of playing football.
Well, I don't know whether it's down to the way or whether it's down to the weather or whether it's down to the night. When you interviewed me the last two nights, I told you that God had been kind to us, that we had two good dry pitches and we had, you know, I mean, we had good weather, and we are a running team. We like to move the ball at pace. The first half was exceptionally difficult. The wind did settle slightly in the second half. But again, that's no excuses, and we can make excuses about the weather, because the weather is the same for everybody when you go out and field.
We were a point down when we had a man sent off, Ronan Flanagan. Probably didn't need to put the tackle in the area of the pitch that he was in.
Well, look, to be honest with you, it was that far away from me. I can't exactly see what it was. He came in again later, but you know, the referee deemed it to be yellow card, and that's what happened in the scenario that was in it. You know, you get referees' decisions swing one way and swing the other way, so wasn't that swing that decision swung against us?
The loss as well tonight means that the match against Kildare next weekend is even more important. We've only got three home games this year, and that's one of them out of the way now.
Well, as I said, you've heard me say before, I'm not really worried whether we play Kildare and Cavan or Newbridge or Crow Park or whatever it is. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, the venue ain't the big issue. It's about how you perform when you go out. And if we perform like we perform tonight, especially in the second half, it wouldn't be good enough to beat Kildare.
The lack of maybe an inside, a big inside forward player, seemed to tell there as well to me. We didn't have somebody big and strong in the full forward line that we could use and play long ball in the second half, maybe.
Well, in fairness, I thought the Parapais inside in the second half, once he got left the sweeper inside in them in the first 15 minutes, the one would have a ball in the second half. It wasn't an issue with that. You know, sometimes we look at it and you're playing with a breeze in your back and everybody wants to bomb the ball in, but we didn't really make that decision at half time because that's what we wanted to do. Yet the probably score did come off the two boys on the inside in the first 15 minutes.
Maybe it was the choice of shot in the second half that was the problem. A lot of balls dropped short into the keeper's hand.
Yeah, well, that sometimes is nerves or a fear factor. You know, I mean, you have to back yourself when you're going for that shot, and you know, it probably is a bit unusual in a mini night, and you do knock ball short like that.
Terry, as you said, next up is Kildare. You know, you've four games left in the National League. That win there tonight would have put you into a massive promotion place. Has it put a dent in the plans?
No, we're going to lose games in this division, and we said that from the start. You know what I mean? It's not always going to be a bed of roses. It's still only around three of the league. You know what I mean? There's a lot of football to be played yet. I suppose, as I said before, the magic figure maybe to survive in Division 2 is around 6 points. Probably 3 points will be off that figure. And, you know, you're probably going to need a nine to get promotion, and it all depends how the other results go. In the end of the day, you know what I mean, it's not like the second last round of the league.
Have you any injury concerns? I know that McEnroe wasn't available this evening due to an injury on the ankle or whatever. Any other injury concerns going into the game for next week, and
we'll have to assess where we are this evening after that game, you know, and see what bangs we picked up. McDermott picked a bang very early on in the game. I'm sure Nico's there, we saw Jason was hobbling there a little bit at the end. We'll have to just wait and see and assess it from there.
No problem. Thanks a million, Terry.
Thanks, Mickey.
So that was Micky talking to Terry Hyland.
National Football League, Cavan 8 points down, 1-9. Very disappointing. One forward scored from play. The other point coming from play came from our cornerback, Jason McLaughlin. So 6 points came from frees. That tells a story in itself. The worst thing about it for me was that we looked comfortable up until half time. We were playing against a seriously strong breeze in the first half, and we were within touching distance of them at half time. And we were just saying, like, if they're within touching distance, they'll go push on.
They were 3 points down. Three points, 6-3 at half time. On an evening when conditions were terrible, it was going to be hard for any team to get scores. it meant you had to outscore them by 3 points in the second half. And albeit most people in the press box were saying the same, that they were happy enough to be only 3 points down at halftime, I wasn't comfortable.
No, I wasn't comfortable because we had the point that was being made, I suppose, in the press box was, look at the amount of chances, the attacks that Cavan were after having. Cavan were after having at least twice as many attacks as Down, but Down were more economical with the ball.
I don't actually think they did. Like, Cavan had two wides in the first half, one drop short. Down had one wide, one drop short.
Yeah, but the point being is that Cavan got up into the full forward line and
were turned over. That's the point. And that's 100%. When you say attacks, we got them into attacking areas. But we didn't win. We didn't retain possession in the full forward line. And it was very, very disappointing to see maybe a lack of ideas, I thought. Because you could see in the first half, our full forward line wasn't functioning. And the full forward line remained. You know, they took off Micky Ling, but he was playing out the field. He wasn't playing inside. But there was, when you look down through the bench, even you were saying, well, you know, who's going to go inside as a full forward there or to inside? Or can they even change somebody? Can they bring a midfielder in to go in and try and win some dirty ball? Because it was an evening for your sloggers. It was an evening for the you know, probably the Mossy Cores, maybe the James McEnroes, the boys that have a bit more physical power that just could grind out that result for you. And we didn't see, well, James McEnroe was injured. Mossy Core played with Den, so he wasn't injured. But I was very, very disappointed for the simple reason that they lacked ideas.
The thing about it was is that, you know, in the second half, we had a good, strong wind behind us. It was a gale force at the start, and then it kind of died down a bit after maybe 8 or 10 minutes, a little bit. And as you said, there's nobody that they could put in there. But surely to God, like, Killian Clark would have been worth, like, 15-minute spell in the full forward line. And do what Down did. Mm. Pump long ball in. Just keep pumping it in. Because we had that much possession that if we kept pumping it in, if you keep throwing enough dirt at the wall, it's going to stick.
Yeah.
And you look, the centre half back kicked the ball from his own 65-metre line in the first half, and it went to no player. It was miles away from any of the players that he tried to kick it to, but it bounced inside the square and went over the bar. And maybe that was something that we needed to do. And okay, it's not nice football to watch, just hoofing ball, no. But it was a night for it.
But there's a time. There's a time and a place. And like, and not to, I suppose, well, it's strange to make a contrast to it, but seeing St. Pat's of Cavan in the quarterfinal against St. Junan's from Letterkenny, they played a completely different style of football than they played in the semi-final. They, you know, as in, they adapted to the situation. St. Junan's were playing huge numbers behind the ball, so they had to be slow in the build-up. You know, they tried to break as quick as they could, but if St. Junan's had the number back, then they would change direction, they would come across, they'd make sure that they keep possession until the opportunity created itself, and then they went at it. And then against Oma at the weekend, it was a different scenario. They could play kick passes out from defence, they could open it up. They changed their tactics completely. Cavan seniors don't seem to be able to do that.
Well, I wouldn't agree with that. I think that they have, and all year they have been able to change and adapt, and especially against Down, then the McKenna Cup down in Newry. But apart from that, one thing I noticed was that when we did move the ball out, there wasn't as many runners as there has been. There wasn't. There was numerous times we looked inside, and all you had was Martin Dunn in the full forward line. And you're thinking, is someone going to make a run in there? And I'm wondering if the fact that they had such a hard training for the last few weeks, were they thinking, oh, I don't want to make that run,
because I'm not able to make that run.
I'm going to have to run back out.
Maybe it is. And does that bring up the point then that do they not mind about the league? So in order, like, to do the 2.5 or 3 weeks of really hard work and you know, put that into the bank.
It's a crucial game, yeah.
Like, if you'd won that game, you were chasing promotion. You lose that game, you're worrying about relegation. You know, so it's...
Well, I don't...
There's a possibility.
Yeah, there is a possibility.
Had you won that game, you wouldn't have thought about relegation.
You wouldn't have been thinking about relegation
at all.
It's gone. And you would have been saying, right, we've got four games left. If we can get two wins, a draw and a loss, we're going to get promoted.
Yeah.
That would have been enough to get promoted.
That's it. And therefore, give yourself the breathing space that you could do the heavy work, the heavy running that you need to do maybe in championship preparation. but you can do it later on in the league.
When you're safe in the league.
I personally thought it was a bad decision, if that was the reason, and it would add up. They looked tired. They looked like they weren't
Matt
fit to run.
Who's just a live wire.
Who was brilliant all year long.
He's player of the season again so far.
Yeah.
You know, he apart from, we'll say, Saturday night, hasn't had a bad game. And it's not that he had a terribly bad game. He just didn't have his normal game on Saturday night against Down. You know, and it just, you know, and in fairness, I know we can say things with different players and whatever, like, they all did try, like, and in the first half, a lot of ball was kicked into the full forward line, and in fairness, it was probably poor ball. The forwards didn't get out in front like they should do, but in the second half, they started winning ball. Now, the ball was put in brilliantly, the likes of Martin Dunne and Niall McDermott. They started winning ball, but the next thing that they did with the ball
was wrong.
You know, and it was like there was a few times you were like going, oh, brilliant, you know, getting the ball on the run, turning into a man, taking a tackle, and then just making the wrong decision. I think they were tired. I think they were mentally tired as well, because there was so many simple mistakes, ball handling errors, you know, kick passes. We discussed a few kick passes, like it wasn't a night for the outside of the boot, yet numerous players tried outside of the boot. The fist pass, as we said already, just basic handling in the first half. And then when they started to get those little things right, then the next thing went, which was the decision-making, kicking the ball, shooting the ball, or passing the ball. And more often than not, they went for the shot when it was a pass, or went for a pass when it was a shot.
It was extremely disappointing, and I suppose it's important to say that this is the exception, not the rule, with this Cavan team. It's the worst performance I've seen in the last year and a half, probably in the last 2 years, by Cavan, probably since... that I've seen now personally, because I missed
one. Worst experience, or worst game ever.
Well, it was the worst one that I've seen since this management took over.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And I don't want it to sound like I'm thinking that, you know, it was only one-off, and once they rectify it and get it back to normal against Kildare, it'll all be forgotten about.
We'll bring up the table, I suppose, and you'll see what this result means to the Cavan team.
You can see Westmeath are now on top, because the Galway game was called off. Westmeath are on top. They have 4 points from 3 games played, so 2 wins and 1 loss. Galway are in second place, but they've only 2 games played, and they have 4 points. Down are in third place, 3 games played, 4 points. Dennis Roscommon, 2 games played, 3 points. And Cavan in fifth with 3 games played and 3 points. So the difference being, had Cavan won, we were top of the table.
Yeah, and instead we've dropped down to fifth. We've dropped down 4 places from second to fifth. Yeah. You know, it's like looking at the table, you know, you look down there and you see that Laois and Kildare, you know, are languishing at the bottom of this. They would have been two of the teams that would have been tipped for maybe promotion back out of this. Kildare is next up for Cavan. It's a huge game.
Like,
absolutely
that's
huge.
That makes it all the more important that Cavan have to beat Kildare, because it keeps them down on the relegation end.
And it means that the 5 points that Cavan have will more than likely see
keep them
through.
Safe. But because it actually leaves then, that's the fourth game. That means Laois have only 2 games played, but Kildare at maximum can reach 4 points, so they can't catch Cavan if Cavan win.
They could get to six, they'd have 3 games left, is it?
After the Kildare game.
And not only that, but had Cavan won against Down, it would have taken...
Oh, sorry, no, you're right, they could get to six.
It could have taken the pressure off them
going into
the Kildare game. Kildare with no wins, Cavan with 5 points from 3 games, unbeaten. Kildare, you know, 3 losses in a row. You know, the pressure would have been all on Kildare.
This result,
it just brings a little bit of pressure on to Cavan. I don't think it brings a whole pile. Kildare are still in a worse position than us.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know, they're in a way worse position. And I do think that they'll bounce back. I think they might be rested this week. And, you know, it'll be good to see them pushing on next weekend.
So, as we say, Cavan take on Kildare this coming Saturday night in Kingspan Breffni Park at 7 o'clock. Please do get back out and support these boys. You know, it's when the chips are down that we need to really get out and put our shoulder to the wheel and show that we do love the Cavan football team. We love supporting them. And, you know, if we can get out in big numbers, it'll show them, it'll help lift them. It'll definitely lift the players. So let's all get out there and be as noisy as we can be in Kingspan.
And, you know, there's a bit of rivalry between Cavan and Kildare over the last a number of years. And, you know, like the Kildare people are going to come up in their numbers like they always do to Cavan when they play Cavan. So we need to outnumber them and we need to be louder than them and get behind this Cavan team again. You know, it was a blip on what's been a great season so far.
That's it. We'll move on to the Tesco Homegrown National Football League Division 2 game where Cavan ladies took on Down. That was over in Yorry. I think it was in the Abbey. Grammar School.
Yeah, that's right. I was at that game, so I was.
You were at that game while being in Castle Blaney. But Cavan came out with a massive win here. 9 goals and 21 points to Down's 1 goal and 3. Absolutely phenomenal result there.
Yeah, the Cavan ladies were leading by 4 goals and 7 points to 2 points at half time and added another 5 goals and 15 points to that in the second half, Down only adding a goal and a point. There was some wonderful performances on in this game. You know, I suppose everybody played well in this game, but there were some high scorers. I know that Roisin O'Keefe got player of the match and scored 2 goals and 8 or 9 points. All the work was done in the first half. There were 19 points to 2 up at half time, and that's, you know, enough to demoralise any team, and Down weren't able to come back in the second half. The first half scores, like, and just to give you a quick rundown of who got the scores in the first half, Aisling Doonan had a goal and a point, Donna English had a goal and a point, Roisin O'Keefe had a goal and 2, and obviously added a goal and 7 in the second half. Aisling Sheridan had 3 points on the board, and Clara O'Reilly had got the goal through a penalty in the second half. There was that many scores, Twitter couldn't keep up with it, so it couldn't.
Absolutely phenomenal performance. And next up then for the Cavan ladies is their match against Armagh. And we'll just bring up the table there in a minute where you can see the Tesco Homegrown. There we have it on the screen. Tesco Homegrown Division 2 table. Cavan sitting on top, 4 games played and 12 points because there's 3 points for a victory in the ladies. Donegal have also 4 games played and 12 points. So the third place team then is Armagh. And the only game that they've lost was against Donegal. So that's going to be a massive game now on the 15th of March.
Interestingly enough, if you look at that table, Cavan are sitting pretty on the top of the table. Absolutely. Their next 3 games, Armagh, Donegal and Meath. The three teams just below them. They've managed to beat all the teams down the bottom, which is brilliant. And they've given themselves a fighting chance of getting promoted. Not only that, but winning is a habit.
Yeah.
And these girls are used to winning now. So they're just going to push on. I actually took that from Twitter. You can see Mona Sheridan had tweeted the table just after the game. And you can just see how excited she was. You know, another great win. Still top of Division 2. Hashtag believe in blue. Hashtag 4 out of 4. You know, this is the mentality of this team. And it's wonderful to see them sitting at the top of that table. Like, and I have to say thanks to Lisa O'Brien, Connor Barry and Carol Kiernan for all their help on the weekend, getting updates to us, getting the Twitter feed out. Absolutely brilliant and for organising.
And they're putting
in
a huge effort to promote the game. So that's their 2 away games out of the way. As we said, this next game against Armagh is at home, more than likely in Kingspan Breffni Park or the 3G, one or the other. So we need to get big support out. It's on the 15th of March. So
Sunday week.
Cavan are playing Galway on the same day over in Galway. But anyone who doesn't go to Galway, get into Breffni Park and support the ladies.
Uh-huh.
We just have a quick picture of the Cavan ladies team there before the game. We'll have it coming up quickly, I think. Maybe not. We'll get it again. We'll get it next week. We'll move on because we're running out of time. We've gone over time already. Wrong of us not to mention about Congress was on at the weekend in the Sleeve Russell Hotel, so the GAA Congress for 2015, and it saw the installation of Aegon O'Farrell as Uachtaráin Cumann Lúchlasc Gael for the next 3 years. In his acceptance speech or first speech, he covered everything, pretty much everything across the GAA, from club to county to schools to handball to camogie to score to football to everything. He had a special mention, of course, for Paul Brady, and it basically saying how the minority sports need to get more coverage. And it'll just be interesting to see now, can he deliver that? Can he get these minority sports, the likes of Paul Brady, who's probably the greatest handball player the world has ever seen, can he become the superstar that he should be? Like, will they raise his profile in the GAA?
Like, you look at how they treat handballers in America, you know, and they're complete stars. Now, look, Paul Brady, probably, I don't know if he'd want to be a complete star or whatever, but he deserves more recognition. Mm. He deserves a bit more, you know, help along the way, because he's done it all himself. You know, okay, and he has had a couple of sponsors down along the way and whatever, but most of it is down to his own, you know, training,
attitude and effort,
you know, yep. And he's a wonderful, wonderful sportsman and one of the greatest that we've had in this country.
Yeah, without a doubt. There was a number of motions, just a couple of them to go through, I suppose. There was ones going about hand passing back to goalkeepers and restrictions. They were all thrown out, they weren't passed.
All the Gaelic football ones were thrown out.
Yes,
they?
As in changes of rules.
Yeah.
But there was one accepted that will affect minors from 2016. So you can't play adult football until you're 17. Now, from 2016 on, you have to be 17, not 17 years of age. So you can't be under 17 and play senior football. So that'll affect some clubs.
It's good and bad.
It's good and bad.
Yeah.
I like the idea. It also brought up that county minors won't be allowed to play with their clubs through all county football leagues or challenge matches when they're involved with a county minor panel, which I think is a very good idea. I think mm-hmm. it's sensible. So that was excellent. Pádraic Duffy in his report brought up a very interesting point about the Sky deal. Lots talked about it and he mentioned that after a year of Sky covering our games, are we worse or better off from it? And a delegate from Leicester stood up and said that the participation in the GAA over in Leicester since the games have been shown on Sky has gone through the roof.
Excellent.
So that's a positive. Yeah. That's a positive.
It can only be a positive.
There's no more arguing for it. The only point that he did make was we're showing 100 games live for free to air, but are we showing too many? Is it affecting the attendances at these games? And that's a big debate, and I think he could be right on that. Maybe there needs to be something done. It's very easy for people to sit at home and watch the games now, whereas they used to go out and watch them.
Well, like the game just gone on Saturday night, it was shown live on Satanta Sports, and I know numerous people who had planned on going, but when they found out that it was going to be on Satanta Sports,
didn't go.
Decided to sit in and watch it on the TV or go to the pub and watch it. You know, and
that's it.
You know, you can't be heard screaming when you're in the pub.
That's
or
it.
When you're sitting at home, you know, we need you at the pitch.
It's a good debate. But anyway, we'll move on very quickly. We want to wish, obviously, Aegon the very best of luck. And maybe sometime, well, I think that there's an interview with, or Louise was down. So tune into All About Sport on Wednesday evening here on Cavan TV. But some stage in the future, we'll catch up with Aegon and maybe have him on the show.
We will indeed.
It would be great. But I want to just mention very quickly that we have the coaching defensive play in football, which will take place. It's a coaching course, take place next Monday night, March the 9th at 7:30 in Kingsman Breffni Park on the 3G pitch, taken by Tony Scullion. Excellent course. I done the one last week with Roger Keenan on attacking play in football, and it was just absolutely brilliant. So if Tony Scullion's is as good as that, get in if you can. And then 2 weeks later, there's a goalkeeping one. So get in, Cavan coaches, get out and try and learn as much as you possibly can, because these lads have a world of information.
Exactly, and learn from the best.
Yeah, so we're just going to give another quick mention about the event coming up in April from Breffni to the Bronx. It's Cavan taking on New York for the Mick Higgins Memorial Trophy, and it's a two-game tournament which will take place in Gaelic Park in New York. The first game?
Yeah, the first game will take place on April the 9th, and it's at 7:45 p.m. local time, that's New York time. And the second leg is on Sunday, April the 12th at 4:30 p.m. local time. So that'll be 11:30 in the morning. 11:30
in the night. 11:30 in the night here.
Oh, will it?
Yeah, 11:30 in the night here. Yeah.
11:30 in the night. We'll have to just check on that.
Sorry, 4:30, 9:30. 9:30, 5 hours
behind. We're 5 hours behind.
No, we're 5 hours ahead of New York.
We'll come back to that one.
We're 5 hours ahead of New York. So it's 9:30 at night, local time. And actually, that game, we're 90% sure, will be broadcast live on Shannonside Northern Sound, or definitely on Northern Sound. So we'll be bringing you that from Gaelic Park in New York. We'll be bringing you lots of information and hopefully getting some Skype interviews set up with some of the organising committee from New York and maybe some of the players. I believe Owen McPhillips is back involved with the New York senior team this year.
Yep.
So he could be one we talk to, or Michael Riley. There's a good few of New York people over there that we need to get in contact with. But keep tuned for the Mick Higgins Memorial Tournament information here on Gaelic Football Views on Cavan TV. So that brings us to the end of this week's show. Remember, if you want to get in contact with your views, we'd be delighted to hear from you.
Yeah, so you can email us on gaelicfootballviews@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook by searching Gaelic Football Views, or you can follow us on Twitter @GaelicFV.
Our thanks to the backroom team tonight of Brian and Zach for always being there to give us the thumbs up whenever we need it.
Yeah, sometimes we just don't feel good about ourselves, and once you get the thumbs up from the two boys, you know everything's going to be A-OK.
And our thanks to the Cavan ladies minor team who came in, and I think you'll all agree they were great crack, wonderful guests, and great
two
attitude.
Jerry's as well, absolutely brilliant, you know, and it's wonderful to see that the two boys have them so relaxed, you know, going into an Ulster championship. So I suppose until next week, it's good night from me, and
God bless.